Power of the Ladies of the Lake brand. It stands for passion. It's authentic. It's got real people behind it. It came from an idea and translated into action and then built from there and there and there. All good stuff. Now, a panel discussion, Annabel Slaight, our co-founder and president, and Lorraine Menon from Pathways to Perennials is here, and they will give us a back and forth with Deborah McGrath, one of our directors, acting as the moderator. She is a toastmaster and will take it over from there. So I think we'll move right along into the agenda.
Assets compared to your current liabilities of $29,119 is just over 3-1, which was raised for the Splash Festival. $138,000. The rewilding Keswick Creeks, $128,000. And the Ontario Water Research Center. The research, you've raised $94,955. And the water, the business plan, $25,000. So you've done a great job in keeping track of raising the monies that you need for the focus of your what you've done in the last year.
And perhaps that trail, instead of just being a science trail, because remember we are talking about an organization that wants to integrate things, would not be in a narrow silo. It would have history, it would have culture, it would have recreation, it would have the environment, it would have the economy, and that you could access this from your computer, from your smartphone, from your GPS in your car, and ultimately the trail could be have places along the way where you could take your smartphone and you could download interactive information. This is called augmented reality, and it's a very hot new idea. So then this would start to put Lake Simcoe on the map as a place where technology and communications and creativity are helping connect people to the land and to the water. Yeah, from the southwest corner of the lake and down south, from the southeast corner of the lake, and from the northeast corner of the lake. Today, as part of my report, to talk a little bit about branding. This year we have had the good fortune of having folks from Shaw Communications. Shaw is going to be one of the media sponsors for the Splash Festival this year, and they're doing some other work with us on communications. And they have brought to the fore a company in New York called Interbrand. And Shaw and Interbrand have been helping us think a bit about things that we've given them. They've asked us a lot of questions, and they have come up with this statement. The Ladies of the Lake brand is so strong and so powerful, it is like the garage where the Apple was built. If you ever walked along the street in your Ladies of the Lake t-shirt, and you found people go, hi, or hello, or oh, there are the Ladies of the Lake. Has that ever happened to anybody?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You know why. It's a very, very strong brand, and that is something very good that we need to be very proud of, and it is a tribute to you all that it is that a strong brand. We'll just touch back, for some of you, on the roots of that brand. The story, of course, began in the Maskinonge River, where some of us were paddling with Claire Malcolmson, who I'm pleased to say has just had a baby, for those of you who know her.
Right.
And the canoes would not go any farther because of the weeds and algae in the river. Jane Meredith and I were in one of those canoes. Actually, we weren't. She was in one canoe and I was in another. And it was just the sort of aha moment that made us wonder, if we shouldn't really get involved, if we shouldn't really roll up our sleeves and try and do something to help the lake. We had, prior to that, asked some politicians what they felt was the health of the lake, and by and large, there was an election going on at that time. The politicians were saying, well, you know, nobody really cares all that much. And we said, I think that we think differently. And we go to the next. The first thing we did, of course, there were 68 of us who were involved in creating and selling that calendar, which earned $250,000, and the next calendar earned $200,000, and this sort of set our brand in motion. Basically, our brand is, and that's what do people expect from you. We appreciate good fun. We involve a lot of people. And we do, in addition to projects, we base our projects on research, and we carry them out with maximum collaboration. So we've been pretty effective, actually, and if we go to the next slide. Remember those of you who were there when the Lake Simcoe Protection Act was announced, and Dalton Medinke, taken with the ladies of the lake. And indeed, that photograph sat on the computers in Queen's Park for at least a year that I know of. So we have done, as you know, many, many projects over the years. One of the beginning ones was to do some research that made the lake understandable and easy to read by taking people's questions and then using science answers to answer them. And we like to say that that research report, which was called The Naked Truth, Science Behind Lake Simcoe, could be read while you drank 1.5 glasses of wine. Following that, we did The Naked Truth Citizens Action Plan. And this, in a number of categories, based on 4 workshops around the lake and then a bringing together of people at a 5th workshop. There were 300 people involved in this. And basically, this was a blueprint for, from the citizens' point of view, of how the lake could be helped. And it's been a blueprint for us as well. I mean, we were involved in it, so of all the people who would read it, although I have to say, it was very interesting to go into people's offices, like went to see MP Peter Van Loan one time, and this thing was just lying on his coffee table. So if you publish in a different kind of way, instead of going on a shelf like a dusty old thing, it's something that people actually do look at. One of the things in this report that came up over and over again, it was the basis of everything that we did, but one of the things that came up over and over again was that there could be and should be perhaps some kind of center, some kind of water center, a place where people could learn, get involved with water, and would be more permanent. Because one of the things that we do see here is that groups come and go, government interest comes and goes, and there are, of course, many permanent things on the lake, because this is a fantastic place, because there are so many different citizens groups involved and so many government levels involved, and things like the Conservation Foundation and the Conservation Authority are there at as the backbone of so much. But it's very interesting the way all the different groups have kind of figured out niches for themselves. But one thing that brings everybody together is actually getting involved. And the people who were involved in this wondered if that couldn't be done in a more permanent way. So the work began with some research on what would a water center on Lake Simcoe really be like. First of all, it wasn't an idea that had any lakes at all. And yes, it did. And what would it be like? You know, one of the things it should not be is duplicating the work of anybody else. It has to add value. And so these were sort of the basic principles that have been developed over the past couple of years. Water is all, don't need to tell you that. It's everything. It's people, it's the lake, it's the rivers, it's the forests, it's everything. It is the first principle that we began with. And that the role of the Water Center could be to engage all, so get researchers, scientists, artists, kids, families, all kinds of people involved in thinking about fish it, drink it, swim it, love it. And the love it part of it is something that we, actually they who did this, added to the, lots of people are talking about drink it, swish it. Swish it, and swim it. But we, this group here was what added love it. And really one of the principles of that is that if we all stop hurting the lake, it has an opportunity to heal itself. You can't really fix a lake. You have to help people to stop hurting it. So with the principle that we would engage all kinds of people, then the mission would be to create ripples, just have things go out and out and out. Now, what is it going to actually do? There were a bunch of workshops over the past year. And these are just some of the notes that were taken. There was the De La Salle Hall was filled with people writing on tables, writing on walls, building models, doing all kinds of things. That we decided that we did not want to do a great big expensive building that would mean that the building itself could overtake the mission. In other words, you could end up saying, oh my gosh, we have to get four more weddings in here to meet the bottom line instead of thinking about your programming. So is that Cynthia, I think you were there at that event, was maybe everyone should be brought together with the idea of some kind of trail that would go all the way around. So not just on around the water itself, but through the watershed. Possibilities, stories, corporations could be involved. And so this brings us to rewilding, which has been ongoing and doing some really interesting things. You heard last year about the people at Pine Beach who rewilding gave this community the tools to imagine their home in different sorts of ways, their shared beach facilities, their parks. And they did that by looking at it all, not from their own perspective, but from the point of view of a fox, a hummingbird, and a bear, each of which had scientific properties. So it got people up off the ground and not looking at things and fighting for their ideas. Everybody became transformed by this process. Rewilding has moved forward in some very interesting ways. We have put in a major, major proposal to the Lake Simcoe Cleanup Fund, which is now the Lake Simcoe and Georgian Bay Cleanup Fund. And we are hopeful that with the following partners, the City of Barrie, the City of Georgina, the City of Kawartha Lakes, the University of Waterloo, the MNR, the Conservation Authority, the Ladies of the Lake, and several other people, this very big project will take place to start to move the rewilding project around the lake and also do some research into attitudes as well. Next. The other thing that happened last summer, and some of you may have seen these guys at Splash, we were very successful to get the United Way very excited about a project to help young people imagine what the future could be and what kind of businesses they might have if they were inspired by the environment. And we were absolutely thrilled that the folks at Mary Home, who were there, wave Mary Home, said, do come to our property, our home, And the kids, this little group of kids, made their summer home at Mary Home. And it was a truly inspiring experience for them. I think what they were most fascinated with, actually, was there are phenomenal trees there. And they watched the ants going up and down the trees, and they looked at these trees, and they touched them, and they looked at the lake, and they looked at the land, but they kept coming back to the trees. And so when it came time for them to work out what kind of a project they would do, what kind of a business they might start, they decided that they would build eco-friendly tree houses. But they didn't want to call them tree houses, because that's boring and grown up. They call them tree lounges. And so these kids, several of whom have severe challenges in their lives, two of them actually live in the youth shelter in Sutton, came up with the designs, working with consultants, came up with the marketing plans, went to the lumber yards, negotiated the wood, and they had one of their grandfathers was helping. So this was an intergenerational project, and it was phenomenal. And when they took the tree lounge, to Splash, they had three people who said they would be interested in ordering them. Unfortunately, the funding has not yet come through for that either, because it's also attached to the Lake Simcoe Cleanup Fund project. So the kids are waiting this summer, but we're hoping to get them together just to help them from losing hope. Next. And that brings us to Splash. This was the Splash first year. As you know, Splash is it is everything that the Water Center is going to be in a short event. It's multidisciplinary. It brings the arts, science, learning, fun, recreation all together. It is collaborative. There are many, many partners involved in Splash. And it is a way to bring the idea of the Water Center to the fore without us just talking about it behind closed doors. It puts it out there so people can experience. You know, we probably haven't been able to explain just exactly what the Water Center was going to be, but we have, because that has been advancing as well. But we should be able to do that this year. Next. So here is Splash for this year. There are four refreshing and cool events you're going to love this summer. It just shows you the depth of the partnerships that are involved in this. Next slide, please. So here are the four events. On the night of the full moon in Sybil Point Park is Moonapalooza, which we have been working with people at Georgina Island, the Chippewa, and other Native people to involve people in interesting cycles. So it's all about what goes around comes around. And there'll be music and some Native teachers, and a beautiful labyrinth is being built for the occasion. People can walk in. So it's going to be quite a wonderful experience at night. And a lot of drumming that people can be involved in as the moon comes up. The second event shows another collaboration in Brock. Brock Big Bite is a festival on the main street of Beaverton that has been going on for a couple of years. And this helps that festival get better known at the same time as it helps Splash expand. So we've had a real collaboration with the people in Beaverton on this, and it's a long lunch on the main street. And there will be farmers there talking about the connection between local food, chefs talking about local food, and of course it all ties to water. Water is the essence